आइटम। फर्स्ट आइटम इन बैलेंस शीट इज करंट एसेट्स। व्हाट आर करंट एसेट्स? व्हाट आर करंट एसेट्स? ग्रेटर देन एयर, लेस देन एयर। सो assets that have a life of less than 1 year or the resources through which economic benefits are expected to flow to the organization within a year are known as current assets. And key examples can include cash and equivalents, marketable securities, trade receivables, inventories and other current assets. Normally you will see this term cash and equivalents being summed up and reported on the balance sheet, but this cash and cash equivalents does not only mean that it has cash. It also has any most liquid instrument. So if there is any instrument which is as liquid as cash, that is also a part of cash and cash equivalents. So for example, any T-bills or any money market funds that are very liquid or that can be immediately converted into cash without any loss are also carried in cash and cash equivalents. Marketable securities includes investment into your T-bills or investment into money market securities or in any investment which has some, let's say, for 1 month, 2 month, 3 month, or which has a life of less than 1 year, that is carried here in marketable securities. Trade receivables, you would already know, receivables from the customers. Inventories, your physical products, and any other current assets like prepaid expenses, deferred tax asset, or any other current asset. So current assets primarily have these components. There can be many other components as well that are carried in other current assets, but these are the major components. Starting with trade receivables. So when we talk about trade receivables, there are two types of trade receivables: gross trade receivables and net trade receivables. Usually on your balance sheet, you will only see net trade receivables. So this net trade receivables number is reported on balance sheet. But as an analyst, when you are looking at the receivables, you should also find out gross trade receivables, and you should also find out the trend or relationship between gross trade and net trade receivables. Because what is being reported on balance sheet might not be enough. Why? Because net receivables are gross receivables minus allowance for bad debt, which is also known as provision for bad debt. So when you have receivables from the customers, there is always a chance that your customer can default. Or if your receivables life increase, so for example, agar ek mahine mein pay karna tha aur 6 mahine ho chuke hain, so there is always a chance that customer can default. Or maybe customer is not able to pay you or may not pay you in future. So in order to account for that risk, you are required to book an allowance for bad debt or a provision for bad debt. This is a loss that you book today in the expectation of a default at some point in future. So, अगर आपको लगता है कि फ्यूचर में कोई डिफॉल्ट होगा आपके डेटर्स पे या डेट बैलेंसेस पे, सो व्हाट यू डू इज यू बुक अ प्रोविजन और अलाउंस फॉर इट एज ऑफ टुडे एंड रिकॉर्ड इट एज अ लॉस। दैट अलाउंस दैट यू आर बुकिंग टुडे इज नोन एज अलाउंस फॉर बैड डेट और प्रोविजन फॉर बैड डेट। सो ओवर टाइम अगर आप अलाउंस बुक करते रहेंगे या प्रोविजन बुक करते रहेंगे, इट विल कंटिन्यू टू इंक्रीज। एंड ये जो प्रोविजन होती है, दैट इज नेटेड ऑफ अगेंस्ट ग्रॉस ट्रेड रिसीवेबल। सो लेट्स से अगर कस्टमर से आपका रिसीवेबल है $100, अगर कस्टमर से आपका रिसीवेबल है $100 एंड यू थिंक दैट फ्रॉम दिस $100 $10 विल नॉट बी रिकवर्ड, सो यू विल बुक $10 एज प्रोविजन एंड देन योर नेट रिसीवेबल्स विल बी $90। नेक्स्ट ईयर अगेन लेट्स से यू हैव अ रिसीवेबल ऑफ $100, नाउ यू थिंक दैट इन एडिशन टू दिस $10 $5 मोर मे डिफॉल्ट, और यू थिंक $10 की जगह जो मुझे टोटल लॉस होगा दैट विल बी $15, दैट इज $5 एडिशनल लॉस। So you will book a provision of $5 in next year, and that will add up to 15, and so your net receivables will be $85. So on your balance sheet you will be seeing, or you whatever number is reported on balance sheet, that is of net receivables. And usually gross receivables or allowance for gross receivable bad debt is provided in notes. So whenever you are analyzing receivables, one key thing to note is that what is the relationship between gross receivables and net receivables. Why is it important? Because this estimate of allowance or this estimate of provision is management's choice. So management would be taking some kind of estimate, or management would be making some kind of judgment about this provision, about this bad debt provision. Or agar management apni earnings badhana chahti hai, if management wants to overstate its earnings, what management can do is management can reduce this provision allowance. Or on the other end, if management want to save taxes or if management want to cut down its earnings or under-reported earning, management can increase the provision. So this is solely or this is based on the judgment or estimates of the management. So management can change it or manipulate it to manipulate the earnings. So that's why it is important to analyze the trend between gross receivables and net receivables. So you should check out that how much of the total receivables are booked as bad debt provision, or what is the percentage of provision of bad debt as what is the provision of bad debt as a percentage of gross receivables, that how much of the total gross receivables are not expected to be recovered. If this number is going up high, that means risk associated with recoveries is increasing, and if this percentage is going low, maybe company is using some aggressive measures and maybe company is trying to over report its earning, but by cutting down the provision charge or by cutting down the expense. So whenever analyzing the trade receivables, one key thing to note is the percent is provision for bad debt as a percentage of gross trade receivables and the trend or the change in this percentage over time. And if there is any significant change, then you should go to management discussion and analysis part to find out the reasons for that change, that what is actually causing that change. This provision term and bad debt expense are two different things. Bad debt expense is the expense recorded on income statement for the period, and provision is the amount, is the total amount that you have booked so far. So for example, in first year, let's say your receivables were $100 and you think that $10 will not be recovered, so that is your provision. This $10 is recorded on income statement and this $10 is also reported on balance sheet as allowance or maybe netted off against gross receivables. Then in second year, you again have $100 of receivables, but now you think there is $5 more of expense. That is, you think ke $5 ke aur receivables hain that might not be covered or that might not be recovered over in the future, or there is $5 more of chances of default. So what you will do is you will book additional $5 of expense in next year, and your total provision will now be $15. That is $10 plus $5. So your provision will continue to increase as you book more and more expense, or as you as the credit risk increases more and more. But the expense charged to income statement will only be the difference of provision and not the total provision. But the amount being netted off against the gross receivables will be the total provision. So if total receivables, gross receivables are $100, your provision is $15, your net receivables reported on balance sheet will be $85. Any confusion so far? So what is in this example, what is the amount of gross receivables in 2009 and 2008? Okay guys, so this reported number is net receivables. This is net receivables. And they have already told you that this is the account receivable less allowances of $52 and $47. That is, they have subtracted $52 from here and they have already subtracted $47 from here. So your formula is that gross receivables minus allowance for bad debt is your net receivables. So if your allowance for bad debt is $52 and your net receivables are 3361, your gross receivables will be equal to 3413 for 2009, and for 2008 it will be 2422 plus 47, whatever the answer is. 2242 plus 47 for 2008. Okay guys, moving on. What is we have done the amount of gross receivables. Net receivables is already given here, that is 3361 and 2422. What is the percentage of bad debt allowance? 2.86%. Here, So let's move on. What are the factors that can cause decrease in allowance for doubtful debt as percentage of receivable? So there can be different factors leading to it. If there is any significant change, you as an analyst need to find out the reasons for that change or the factors for that change. Factors can be improvement in credit quality of the existing customer. So maybe customers jo unki credit quality improve ho gayi, agar unki credit quality improve ho jayegi, there will be lesser expectations or lesser chances of default. And if there are lesser chances of default, company can reduce its allowance for bad debt provision. Stricter credit policies, maybe company pehle 6 months ka ya 4 months ka ya 3 months ka credit period deti thi. Maybe it has reduced the credit period. So if it reduces the credit period, your outstanding balance will be lower. And if your overall outstanding balance becomes lower, then obviously your allowance will also be lower. Why? Because agar aapka $100 ka debt outstanding hai or receivable outstanding hai, your provision will be higher. But if your $10 of receivable is only outstanding, then your provision will be lower. So 2%, for example, 2% of $100 will be $2 and 2% of $50 will only be $1. Stricter risk management policies. So maybe some companies can buy protection or buy insurance on their receivables. So if they have bought insurance on their receivables, again that reduces the risk. And if risk is lower, then allowance for bad debt or provision for bad debt will also be lower. Management may change the estimate to manipulate the reported earnings. This we have already discussed, that management is estimating the allowance for bad debt, and management can play with the policies or can change or manipulate policies to manipulate the overall reported earnings. So these are some reasons that can lead to decrease in allowance for doubtful debts. When you are analyzing your companies, go into checking the doubtful debt recognition policies and check the trend in doubtful debt as a percentage of receivables. And if there is any significant change, find out the reasons for that change or factors for that change.